Good morning all. This is week two of painting still lifes, and this week I am attempting a still life without drawing and trying to paint loosely. That's not scary, is it? Anyway, I know some of you also particularly like drawing with charcoal, so if I have time I'm going to show you a little bit about how to use charcoal. And there's no obligation to go down the charcoal route unless you want to, but it's quite fun to use and quite forgiving, and at Christmas we do tend to just go off piste a little bit and do something different just for fun, and it's actually very good practice for drawing. Okay, also some of you have requested Christmas cards. I have many ideas for Christmas cards, so I've tried to restrict myself, but we'll show you a few suggestions that that might be helpful to you to make some original cards quickly. I'm very disappointed not to be able to actually run my Christmas card course this year, but never mind. Bringing Christmas into the YouTube will be quite nice too, so we'll see how that goes. Not getting into Christmas too much with this still life, apart from the fact that I'm going to create a painting that has a little bit of a theme to it. It's going to be like a cup of tea, but my nod to Christmas is it's cranberry tea. Okay, so these are the subjects that I've got set up in front of me. A little tea bag in a dish, my mug, and a spoon. So three items there will work quite well, hopefully. As I said, I'm not going to draw, and I'm going to try and paint loosely and see how that works out. My mug has got a bit of a creamy tinge to it, so I'm actually going to mix a little bit of Naples yellow into my, I've got neutral tint out, and I've also got some Payne's grey going on because I want to leave white paper showing, so this will make quite a nice colour, I think, a softer grey, and little hints of yellow going on in there as well. Also, I've stood the still life on some red, so it hopefully will reflect up a little bit of red as well, which will help with the fact that it's a cranberry tea, and I'll put a bit of red in that tea bag. Right, so I'm going to start with the mug, and I'm going to position it just off centre. Obviously it's the focal point, so that's going to be just off centre, and being careful about the shape that I'm putting down in the first place. The shadow mostly is on my left hand side, which is rather nice, so I can leave the other side nice and free. And I've also got to think about leaving space to put the little dish in, which is standing slightly in front, breaking up the shape of my mug. I've got a flat brush out just so that I can lift off any little areas of light as I go along. I just want to get this basic shape in first. It's a big fat mug. Giving it a little bit more height, actually. I need to think about the thickness of the top of the mug. There's quite a bit of depth inside here. So I'll pop that in while it's still wet. Don't be afraid to put the darks in. They're always going to make the lights look lighter and give your picture strength. So I'm going to emphasize that shadow down that side a little bit more. There's reflection in there from the red, which is nice. I'll pop that in. And I'm using alizarin for that. It's a good colour for cranberry. Right. Again, showing the thickness of the rim of the mug. I've also got some ultramarine out, so I think I'll occasionally pop a little bit of the blue in as well. Bringing a little bit of that creamy colour in, but I'm also going to leave quite a bit of white for the shine and for the contrast. Right, it has a little heart motif on there. Which again isn't in the centre, so off centre with that. Which will look better. I emphasise one side of that heart a little bit more than the other. That might look good. Get that little point in as well. But it's got some light shining into it, which helps to show that that heart is part of the design of the mug, rather than something that's sitting on the outside of it. Right, well, that's not a bad shape. We're leaving a space here for the little dish. Lots of water when you're painting loosely like this, and letting the water and the paint actually do quite a lot of the work for you by leaving it and not touching too much. Right, I'm going to deal with the handle now, which comes quite high up, and it's not sticking out from the side, but a little bit from around, because it's not standing straight. It's actually coming from behind a little way. So that sort of thing adds more interest, but more difficult to paint. Right, don't want any hard lines. So if you draw a hard line like that, try to bring it in quite quickly so that it isn't harsh. There's some light So when you use your lifting out brush, make sure it's really clean, hasn't got any paint on it. Use clean water. The light was obliterating that little bit, top bit of the handle there. It's darker here. And darker here. And here. Right, that looks all right. I think I'll just leave that. Don't mind this bit being a little bit darker. Right, now I need to work on the dish, which has a tea bag in it. So I'm starting with a tea bag because that's sitting in front of the mug. And it has some nice cranberry leaves in it. And it's in front of part of the dish, so that's why I'm painting that before the dish. So when you're painting without drawing, you have got to notice what's in front and putting depth behind a light area like that's going to help to bring that shape out. So, starting the little bag there. Tea in the tea bag gets quite dark in this corner. Crevice there, a little crease in the bag, so that's looking quite dark. Right, so that bit's showing up quite well. I can start on the dish. See into that dish because it's in the front of the mug. I can see into the dish a lot better than I can actually in the mug. It's quite dark just inside here, which is good. It'll show up my tea bag, the edges of the tea bag. Depth in there. My tea bag's all screwed up because it's wet. It's a used tea bag. There's some tea in the mug. Not much white showing inside that little dish. It's got a lot of shadow in it. So this is the thing, when you're painting white, you're going to have to look at all the shadows there because there won't be that much white showing. And to make the white look white, you've got to put the dark beside it. So there's my little dish coming. Put a bit more tea in there. Here as well. Dark there. Right, my little dish has taken on a reasonable shape. Now, there's depth in this corner and under here, where the shadow is underneath the mug. So that will help me to get the shape back for that quite nicely. It's a bit more red showing down the side here. A little bit of red on the rim of my dish as well. A little bit of red under here for my reds out from last week. Right. Okay, so now I've got to be brave and paint a spoon. But I'm going to put a little bit of tea in here, I think. Can't see any, because there's not really any in there, but should have done that, shouldn't I? So think about that if you're going to have a glass of wine or something, or, you know, paint a drink. Make sure the drink's in there. That's a very full cup, isn't it? I'm going to need a cup of tea after this. So anyway, took a bit away. Just indicating there's some tea in there. Right, now a spoon is not the easiest thing to paint, is it? But anyway, here we go. And that's taking on a very strange angle as well. It's sort of sitting at that angle. I won't look at that one, I will look at that, but that's the angle that it's sitting at, although you'll see it differently to me, because it's over the top. Lots of shine in here. And some red. So if you do paint something metal, I would make sure that you use something like Payne's Grey, but it needs to be the Winsor & Newton Payne's Grey, because it's got a lot of blue in it and it tends to be the right sort of colour. It's the oddest spoon. has an edge to it as well. So that has to take shape here. I haven't actually got that quite right, but never mind. Okay, don't want to spend too much more time on this because I've got other things to show. So I'm going to pop some shadow in. Sticking with these same colours, but also popping red in where necessary. So I'm creating a bit of a tabletop there. I should have measured it, but I haven't. A lot of shadow under here. Trying to be really strong with these shadows to bring the shapes out. I'll dry up lighter. Lovely shadow here. So if you're painting up against a light area, you do need to put the depth in around it. I've almost lost my spoon, which is no bad thing, but I can bring that back up again. So at this point, when it's dried, there'll probably be areas that need just to be brought back again a bit. But try to be careful about that and don't overwork. Because it isn't supposed to be a precise painting. It's supposed to be just a quick, loose indication of what I'm seeing in front of me. That's still a bit wet to be brought back very much, so I'll leave that spoon. He was a bit of a failure, really. I'm sure I could do better if I had more time, but not to worry. But anyway, that's the method, and that's my rendition of my cup of cranberry tea, which I'm going to drink any minute now. Oh, look, that helps. So not terribly good, but not terribly bad either. It is what it is. And so if you try something like that, don't worry if it doesn't always work out as well as you had hoped. But I would take a little bit more time over things than I have to when I'm painting this quickly and with being timed. But I have actually got a new camera going on up here, which does give me a little bit more time than I've been used to, so that's helpful. I'll see if I can bring this back to life a little bit at some point when it's drier. But right now I just want to show you some other bits and pieces. And see what I can do with some charcoal for you, in case you fancy having a little try with the charcoal. I don't actually have a subject particularly in front of me, but I'll just indicate what you can do with charcoal. I have a sketching pencil here, so you can obviously use your charcoal along with a light sketching pencil. You can also use a charcoal pencil. This is a medium one, which will obviously give you more depth. You can also use charcoal sticks, which are lovely really, because you can get huge depth with them. So that's really all you need. I mean, I can send you boxes of charcoal if you haven't got the charcoal at home. And in that box you get varying thicknesses of charcoal, right down to a little fine one like that, which is really, really nice to use. But the other thing you can use is a blender, which is just, I think, made of card or paper or something, but rolled very tightly so that it becomes easy to blend with. Or you can just use your fingers. But you can bring light back in, you can spread it around, do whatever you feel you need to do for your subject. And also lift back off with a putty rubber if you need to bring some shine or some light back in. So that's really all there is to it. You can have a pencil, you can have the chalks or the blender, and or use your finger. So I'll just do one little piece of holly or something. Let me just see if I can draw a piece of holly. And I'll show you some things I did earlier which might give you some inspiration and some ideas of what you can actually do with the charcoal. So it's a matter of drawing it first and then filling in with either a piece of charcoal or the pencil. But I'll use the stick, I think. You can actually create some very nice and quick paintings with these, with the charcoal, or in fact you can spend a lot of time and put a lot of work in, depending on how you feel about it and what you're doing. And to set it, you can actually buy the spray that you spray on to set it, so that it won't, you know, keep coming off and making mess. Or you can use hairspray. I've used both and they both seem to work quite well. So you could go darker this side maybe. Trying to think about Christmas a little bit at the moment, but seems a bit early still, I think, to get too involved. So that has some shine on there. So I've had a half an hour, but I'll be okay. I can keep going. So you can bring some shine back in with the putty rubber. Or any other rubber, I guess, but the putty rubber is quite good because you can actually shape it and tidy up with it. So then a little bit of work into the stalk. What is a nice thing to do is to actually draw something and create a charcoal drawing of something and then paint it with watercolour afterwards, so that you've actually experienced the subject and got to know it well, especially if there's something complicated that you want to do for something. It gives you a very good start to do it with the charcoal first, to get to know that subject. And then paint it again in watercolour. So a little bit of shine on each berry. And that took about, 5 minutes? So, nice thing to do. And I'll show you some other things that I've created with the charcoal as well. More complicated things. Here's the holly again, and a nice dark bauble. Don't forget the shadows. But I also painted over the top of my charcoal drawing, which actually worked really well. I'll just do one berry just to show you what I mean and how it works. So I've drawn it with the charcoal, which gives you a lovely broken, free edge. And then take your brush and I've popped a little bit of yellow underneath. It does blend a little bit, but it's actually nice because it gives lovely shadow. It's just different. Does somehow tend to loosen you up if you do something like this. So if you're having difficulty loosening up, why not try something like this? And actually, very quick card. If you did, you know, a little drawing like that of your charcoal and then paint some colour over the top. Really quick for cards. And as you can see, I tried little Robin by drawing him and colouring him in, and again it would be 5 minutes, so to put that on a card would be really nice, and popping a little bit of background around in between and around creates little pictures. So that's one thing you could actually do for your cards if you wanted to have a go with the charcoal. cones make a nice drawing. Two seems to work quite well in this case because they're close together and touching. Lovely dark shadow underneath, one darker than the other so that the one behind is looking lighter. And then maybe create a similar thing with your watercolour. Again, that's drawn with the charcoal and painted over the top with the watercolour. Another nice thing to give as a present is to paint somebody's shoes, especially if you have children in your family. And little girls often do have dancing shoes and things like that. So maybe draw their shoes and then paint their shoes, or just paint them if you don't want to use the charcoal. But that's a nice present for a little girl for Christmas, or if you have a daughter who wears stiletto heels, paint her shoes to just arrange nicely on the page and look very good. You've got a boy, you could go for the trainers or football boots. Little wellies make nice pictures. Put some holly in the wellies, make a Christmas card or something with the wellies. And but it's personal. If you can get hold of their shoes, you can make it more personal. So their ideas. Bottles, again that could have some colour on, but it actually hasn't. But a nice drawing, and as I said, very good practice for drawing, and it's forgiving. One or two other things that can be done quickly. Go back to the holly, just tear a piece of paper up or have a ragged edge somehow, and quickly just paint some holly on your picture, and then stick it onto the card if you've got spare, you know, separate cards. Blank cards, because you can't always paint on the ones that you buy. It has to be watercolour paper. So doing it like that would really work quite well. And you can get a production line going and do lots of little pictures of holly, perhaps. Masking fluid, which we all know how to use, make really good pictures. Scribble pictures. So what I've done here, and I'll just talk you through it, it's a plain piece of paper. Take the masking fluid and use your sharp tool or whatever you've got, a pen and nib or something, and then just scribble with the masking fluid to create a shape, Christmas tree, whatever. You can also splatter with the masking fluid. Obviously leave it to dry and then paint all the way over the top. Again, leave the paint to dry and then rub it off, and you've got this scribbled image underneath, and you can put a little star on the top, and you can put some glitter on as well if you wanted to. So that's a very quick little card to do. And again, you could get a production line going and do lots all in one time. There's another one with just a slight difference. But I like this indigo colour, it works really well. Or if you want to be really Christmassy, you could use the red. Okay, so they're all just little quickies that you could very easily do. And good practice for using your masking fluid. This one again is using masking fluid. I've blown it with the straw, which I think I've shown you before. Blown it onto the white paper, then painted over the top, and it's created little tree shapes. And I've just put a little parcel, or you could put a little robin, or whatever you fancy at the bottom here. But that's just indicating some trees and some stars. Don't know if you can see that one, but that's just a little wreath. So you could do that on a bigger piece, and that works quite well. Okay, So I'll show you more next week. I'll come up with some more Christmas card ideas for you next week. But there was just one more thing I wanted to show, and that is putting a background. You're probably all fed up with painting glass because we've been doing it, but what we needed to cover also is the fact that you can put a background behind your glass, but if you do, it would have to show through the glass. So be careful about whatever background you put behind, and if you actually use a similar colour behind that you have got already indicating colour and shadow and so on in your vase, then if you put that behind, it's going to work. All right, so don't get too complicated and do anything too fussy in your background, and use different colours, because they will then have to show through and in to your glass vessel, which is sometimes something you don't always think about. Okay, so that's about it, I think. I'm going to demonstrate painting lace a bit later on, because that's a nice thing to feature in your still life, and maybe some material, because that's another tricky subject. Okay, I don't know how my cup of tea has dried up. It's not looking too bad. It's just I've just lost the spoon a little bit, but I'll try and bring that back and maybe attach it if I like it enough. Okay, next week I'm going to create a still life with line and wash, I think, and also show some more things with cards, with ink and other pens. Okay, so that's for next week. But in the meantime, have a good week, and maybe you could try a nice still life without drawing first and see how that goes. Okay, take care. Bye-bye.